from New York, this is Democracy Now!
Bolivia.
Bolivia will once again be enshrouded in economic growth like we had. This is the only political movement, the movement towards socialism, the political instrument for sovereignty for the people, that has a vision for the country, has a program. That's why we won easily.
Former Bolivian President Evo Morales pledges to return to Bolivia after his Socialist MAS party wins Sunday's election in the first vote since Morales was ousted in a coup 11 months ago. Morales' hand-picked successor, Luis Arce, won Sunday's presidential election outright, avoiding a runoff. We'll go to Bolivia for the latest. Then, as early voting begins today in Wisconsin, we'll look at the increase of voter suppression during the pandemic.
As folks wait for their polling place, you can see
they've made it so difficult for people to vote here, just asking too much of people to come out with this virus going on.
It was a major election in the middle of a pandemic.
There's been confusion around what actually is allowed.
It was difficult to request an absentee ballot.
I didn't even know how to do it.
I didn't know about that option to vote through the absentee voting.
Mail ballots, they cheat, okay? People cheat. Mail ballots are fraudulent in many cases.
Whose vote counts? We'll speak to journalist and professor Jelani Cobb about his new Frontline documentary. All that and more coming up. Welcome to Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, the Quarantine Report. I'm Amy Goodman. As the U.S. death toll from COVID-19 tops 220,000, by far the highest in the world, President Trump has escalated his attack on the nation's top infectious disease expert, Dr. Anthony Fauci. During a campaign phone call, Trump described Fauci as an idiot.
People are tired of hearing Fauci and all these idiots, these people that have gotten it wrong. Fauci's a nice guy. He's been here for 500 years. He's a disaster.
Dr. Fauci responded by saying he just wants to focus on combating the virus, saying, quote, "That's the only thing I really care about. That other stuff, it's like in The Godfather. Nothing personal, strictly business as far as I'm concerned. I just want to do my job and take care of the people of this country," he said. While Trump attacks Fauci, his campaign continues to run an ad that uses Fauci's words out of context, falsely giving the impression that Fauci endorses the president's handling of the pandemic. This comes as COVID-19 cases are surging again across the United States. On Monday, nearly 60,000 people in the United States tested positive and 445 people died. In Kansas, a coronavirus outbreak in a nursing home has killed 10 people and infected all residents and an unspecified number of staff. New Mexico Governor Michelle Lujan Grisham on Monday warned in a tweet, quote, "If COVID-19 continues to exponentially spread like last week, New Mexico will not have the health care and hospital capacity for every New Mexican who needs care." Meanwhile, in California, Governor Gavin Newsom has announced the state will conduct its own review of any COVID-19 vaccine before it's distributed in California. On Capitol Hill, Senate Republicans are planning to move forward a measure on the Paycheck Protection Program today before a larger vote Wednesday on a $500 billion bill. House Speaker Nancy Pelosi and Treasury Secretary Steve Mnuchin are in still talks over a larger coronavirus relief package. Democrats are pushing for a $2.2 trillion aid bill. In a victory for Democrats and voting rights advocates, the Supreme Court has ruled Pennsylvania election officials can count incoming mail-in ballots for up to 3 days after Election Day. A 4-4 tie on the court leaves in place a ruling from a lower court which extended the deadline to count ballots due to the pandemic and delays in postal deliveries. Voting rights groups warn the deadlocked decision by the Supreme Court signals Trump nominee Amy Coney Barrett will cast the deciding vote in any election disputes if confirmed. During her Senate hearing, she refused to say whether she would recuse herself from an election case and refused to say whether a president should commit to a peaceful transfer of power. In other voting news, Florida shattered its record for in-person early voting Monday as over 350,000 people lined up at polling sites to cast ballots. Across the U.S., over 30 million people have already voted in the election, which represents about one-fifth of the total number of votes cast in 2016, shattering all previous records. Early voting starts today in Wisconsin and Utah. In more election news, the Presidential Debate Commission announced Monday it will mute the microphones of President Trump and Joe Biden during parts of Thursday's debate. Mics will be muted while the other candidate on stage is responding to the moderator's question in an effort to avoid the chaotic, interruption-filled scene that unfolded at the first debate, when President Trump interrupted Joe Biden well over 100 times. Evo Morales said Monday he will return to Bolivia following his MAS party's stunning victory in Sunday's election. The former president, overthrown in a coup last year and replaced by a far-right government, did not specify a timeline for his return. His hand-picked successor, Luis Arce, celebrated his win early Monday.
We have recovered our soul. We have recovered the mysticism of this process. The people have made this possible with their discipline. We recovered this process of change for all.
The election was postponed twice by the interim government of right-wing President Jeanine Añez, who cited the pandemic. Protests rocked Bolivia for months ahead of the election, condemning Añez for delaying the vote, as well as her government's military and police violence against indigenous communities and MAS supporters. We'll have more on the elections in Bolivia after headlines. President Trump's announced plans to remove Sudan from the state sponsors of terrorism list in a move that paves the way for Sudan to establish diplomatic relations with Israel. The move may also allow Sudan to relieve its debt through international financial institutions and court new foreign investment. In other news from Sudan, the International Criminal Court has begun talks with officials in Khartoum over arrest warrants for senior political figures, including former President Omar al-Bashir, who was overthrown last year after a mass uprising and is wanted by the ICC on charges of genocide, war crimes, and crimes against humanity. In Nigeria, protests against police brutality show no signs of slowing down, even after police disbanded the controversial Special Anti-Robbery Squad, known as SARS, earlier this month. Tens of thousands of demonstrators took to the streets of the capital, Lagos, in recent days, bringing traffic in the bustling city to a standstill. The capital is actually Abuja. An estimated 15 or more people have been killed and dozens more injured since the demonstration started. Protesters also say they doubt SARS officers will be held accountable for their abuses or that excessive force by police will be curtailed despite recent reforms. In news from the Middle East, the Wall Street Journal has revealed U.S. officials traveled to Damascus in August to hold talks with Syria's intelligence chief to discuss two missing U.S. citizens, the journalist Austin Tice and a Syrian-American psychologist named Majid Kamalmas. This marked the first high-level talks between the two nations in over a decade. According to reports in the Syrian press, the two sides also discussed sanctions and the U.S. military presence in Syria. To see our interview with Austin Tice's parents, go to democracynow.org. In Palestine, Maher al-Akras, a prisoner who's been on hunger strike for 86 days to protest his indefinite imprisonment, is on the verge of death, according to rights groups. The 49-year-old was arrested by Israeli forces in July, but is being held without charges. From his hospital bed, al-Akras called on the international community to help free the Palestinian people. He said, "I refuse to give in to the decisions of this occupying state. I will either return freely to my children and to my people, or I will die without submission," unquote. Tens of thousands of people have been displaced and over 100 have died after heavy storms battered Vietnam, Cambodia and Laos, triggering massive floods and landslides across the region. In Vietnam, 90 people were reported dead, dozens missing. In neighboring Cambodia, at least 25 people have died. This comes as a third cyclone is expected to hit the Vietnamese coast in the coming days. In Colombia, thousands of indigenous leaders and activists have arrived in the capital, Bogota, as they plan to join a national strike this week against the government's social and economic policies. Unions, student groups and others are also expected to participate in the massive protest to demand the government of the right-wing president Iván Duque end the violence and murders against social leaders in Colombia. This is one of the indigenous protesters speaking Monday.
What we want to do is debate with the government led by President Iván Duque. We want him to show his face, to debate the Minga and the Colombian people. There are 4 points. One is the defense of life. They are killing us. They are murdering our social leaders.
The Justice Department in the United States has announced charges against 6 Russian military intelligence officers for hacking the 2017 French presidential election, hacking Ukraine's electricity grid, and hacking the opening ceremony of the 2018 Winter Olympics, as well as investigators looking into the poisoning of former Russian spy Sergei Skripal in Britain. The Russian embassy in Washington dismissed the charges, claiming they were aimed at fueling an anti-Russia witch hunt. None of the charged men are in U.S. custody. The New York Times has revealed officials in the United States and 4 other nations have launched a massive tax fraud probe targeting a Puerto Rican-based bank owned by the prominent libertarian investor Peter Schiff. Hundreds of clients of Euro-Pacific Bank are also being probed for tax evasion. The bank is one of many boutique banks set up in Puerto Rico, which has become a popular tax haven for wealthy investors. And the Supreme Court's agreed to hear 2 major immigration cases that are part of Trump's hardline agenda. The so-called Remain in Mexico program forces asylum seekers to wait in Mexico while their claims make their way through the U.S. court system. The court will also review Trump's diversion of $2.5 billion in Pentagon funds without congressional approval to build his U.S.-Mexico border wall. The cases will not be heard until 2021. If Joe Biden wins the election, he could cancel efforts to move ahead with both plans. And those are some of the headlines. This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The Quarantine Report. I'm Amy Goodman in New York, joined by my co-host Juan González from New Brunswick, New Jersey. Hi, Juan.
Hi, Amy, and welcome to all of our listeners and viewers across the country and around the world.
Well, we're beginning today's show in Bolivia, where former President Evo Morales' political party, MAS, is claiming victory in Sunday's presidential election. The results of the twice-postponed election have not been officially announced, but the centrist former president, Carlos Mesa, conceded defeat Monday as exit polls show Luis Arce has won over half of the vote, giving him an outright win. If confirmed, it will put the Socialist Party back in power, putting an end to the far-right government, which overthrew Evo Morales in a coup in November 2019. Protests have rocked Bolivia for months now, calling out the right-wing government's use of military and police repression and violence against indigenous communities. At a news conference Monday in Buenos Aires, Argentina, former President Evo Morales responded to the election's outcome.
Sooner or later, we are going to return to Bolivia. That's not up for debate. And yes, there are many processes which are part of a dirty war and so many lies. Bolivian brothers and sisters, with experience and with Lucho president, once again will bring Bolivia forward, will pick Bolivia up. In a short time, Bolivia will once again be enshrouded in economic growth like we had. This is the only political movement, the movement towards socialism, the political instrument for sovereignty for the people, that has a vision for the country, has a program. That's why we won easily.
That's former Bolivian President Evo Morales. This is President-elect Luis Arce of the MAS party responding to the election results.
We have recovered our soul. We have recovered the mysticism of this process. The people have made this possible with their discipline. We recovered this process of change for all.
That's President-elect Luis Arce speaking to journalist Ali Vargas, who joins us now from La Paz, Bolivia. We welcome you to Democracy Now!, Ali. Can you talk about the stunning victory that has come outright after Sunday's election? Explain who Arce is and what this means for the MAS party and for the ousted Bolivian president, Evo Morales.
Thank you for having me on and helping to shine a light on what's going on here in Bolivia. It's an extraordinary election. In 2019, Evo Morales won by a margin of 10%, or just over 10%. And now we have a margin of over 20%, with which the left is ahead. So it's an extraordinary election. And Luis Arce, I think you mentioned at the beginning of the show, is a handpicked successor of Evo Morales. That's because he was the economy minister for almost all of the period, almost all of the past 14 years of Evo Morales' government, in which Bolivia went from being the region's poorest country into its fastest growing economy. Even sort of more right-wing outlets such as the Financial Times, the BBC, institutions like the IMF, the World Bank, talked about a Bolivian miracle during Evo Morales' period. For the past before Evo Morales' ousted, for the past 6 years, Bolivia was the fastest growing economy in the region. So I think what the MAS will want to be doing is picking up where they left off. However, a huge challenge now will be the economic crisis caused both by COVID-19, the lockdown measures, but also a series of neoliberal reforms, privatizations, paralyzations of state projects that was taking place before the pandemic hit and has carried on since. So the MAS, the movement towards socialism, the left, the key challenge is rebuilding the economy as they did in 2005. We have to remember that Evo Morales and Luis Arce took power in 2005, swept to power on the wave of popular protest in which former President Carlos Mesa and current centrist neoliberal candidate was overthrown. And Bolivia was in a dire economic crisis at the time. When Carlos Mesa was president, he was taking out IMF loans to pay public sector salaries, to pay teachers' salaries. And out of those, out of that disaster, actually, Luis Arce built what he calls the social, communitarian, productive economic model based on the nationalization of natural resources and strategic industries, and then using those profits to invest in infrastructure, public services, social benefits for the people. So he'll be looking to rebuild that model that was, you could say, destroyed this past year under the current Farc government led by Janine Áñez.
And Ali Vargas, I wanted to ask you specifically, you mentioned Carlos Mesa. He was the right-wing candidate, but could there have been a more clear choice for the people of Bolivia, given the fact that Mesa had previously been both a vice president and president before Evo Morales came to power? Could you talk about Mesa's record that the voters had an ability to judge when they went to the polls?
Yeah, in some ways, Bolivians were kind of lucky insofar as the two main candidates in the election had both been in power pretty recently within the living memory of most voters. As I said at the beginning, Carlos Mesa governed where he was elected as vice president in 2002 together with the widely hated former president Gonzalo Sanchez de Lozada, who fled to Miami in 2003 after trying to privatize the country's natural gas, and after carrying out a series of massacres in the indigenous city of El Alto. He flees to Miami. Carlos Mesa takes power in 2003. And 2003 to 2005 is a period of complete paralysis in Bolivia because Carlos Mesa pledges to not use repression, to not mobilize the military against protesters as his presidential partner did. However, he insists on the plan of privatizing the country's natural gas and exporting it through the port of Chile. And that of course, meant that the social movements, some of which led by Evo Morales, continued their general strikes, continued popular uprising, and the country became ungovernable. And the economic crisis became extreme. As I said, the IMF were brought in to... IMF loans have been taken out to pay for the basic costs of the state, not for investment, but to pay public sector salaries. As I said, the basic costs of the state. So Bolivia was an incredibly disastrous moment in the 2 years in which Carlos Mesa ruled, with the backing, I should say, of the United States. So people have that in their memories, but people also, you know, lived through, experienced the past 14 years under Evo Morales, in which the size of the economy tripled, the incomes of most people tripled at the very least. So those on minimum wage, skyrocketed even further. Unemployment was the lowest in the region. And Bolivia was had the highest rate of GDP growth than any other country in the region. So people have both of those experiences somewhat recently. So it was Bolivians had had the information with which to make a choice, and 52-53% of the country voted for Evo Morales' party, the Movement Towards Socialism.
On Monday, you posted a short video on Twitter writing, quote, "I want to denounce that Bolivian coup supporters tried to assault me just now while I filmed at a polling station in Ciudad Satellite. They know they've lost the vote, so they resort to violence against journalists." This is how Camacho and Mesa supporters operate. This is a clip.
Perdón.
I have the right to film. I'm a journalist. I'm a journalist. Sorry, friend. I'm a journalist. I'm a journalist. And this man... This is violence on behalf of the right-wing groups.
So can you talk about what happened to you, Ali, but also what Jeanine Añez tried to do? She herself said she wouldn't be running for president. She got others to pull out of the race so that the other side, so that they could consolidate and have a chance to win. But even still, Arce won outright with over half the vote.
Yeah, starting with what happened to me on Election Day, I think... What I experienced on Election Day was a microcosm of what this country has gone through this past year. I started my day following Luis Arce, where he went to vote in the middle-class neighborhood of Miraflores in La Paz, at which those lining up to vote were being incredibly aggressive, challenging us to a fight, throwing eggs, throwing water. But tensions, polarization. We left there and we went to Ciudad Satélite with the president of the Senate, the MAS, who belongs to the MAS, Eva Copa, when she went to vote. And when we arrived at the polling station, there was a large group of people already there who were not in the queue to vote, who immediately began being incredibly aggressive, began chanting a number of things. And I began to film what they were chanting. And it was at that point when two men began trying to take my filming equipment. I had a press credential around my neck. They're trying to pull that off. I was punched in the chest. And that sort of hostility continued while Eva Copa was voting and as we left. But then what happened at the end of the day? We got the exit polls, and what we found out was that the country doesn't belong to that violent far-right minority. The country belongs to Bolivia's social movements, to the popular movements who fight for equality, who fight for democracy, liberty, for national sovereignty against U.S. interference. And I think the fact that the MAS would win this, the fact that the left would win this election has been very clear for a number of months. And that's why those who support the current regime have increasingly turned to violence. And another sign of desperation for a long time now has been the pressure on the other right-wing candidates to step down so as to consolidate the right-wing vote behind Carlos Mesa. As you mentioned, Jeanine Añez, she declared a candidacy in January despite pledging not to, and then had to withdraw a candidacy just a few weeks before the elections. She didn't do it in time, so on Election Day when I went to vote, she was still on the ballot. But any votes for her counted as a support ballot. And there was a huge amount of pressure, both from the regime, from the mainstream media. CNN presenter Fernando del Rincón joined in, calling on the other sort of smaller right-wing candidates to step down because it's the only way in which the pro-coup candidate Carlos Mesa could have any chance of forcing the MAS into a second round. But even if they had all united, it wouldn't have made a difference. Luis Arce won. Well, there's been two exit polls. One shows he won with 52%. Another shows that he's won with 53%. So the victory of the MAS is overwhelming. Even with the unity of all the right-wing forces, the MAS would have still won. So it shows us as well, actually, what happened in 2019, when it was, I think, in a number of U.S. Outlets, mainstream media outlets, it was portrayed as a sort of popular uprising that people have rejected Evo Morales. Well, what people were they talking about? They weren't talking about the 53% of the country that voted yesterday. Well, the people they're referring to is a whiter, middle-class, upper-class elite based in the inner circles of the big cities who, yes, did protest in large numbers against Evo Morales. But actually, the voices of the majority of the Bolivian people in the indigenous rural areas, in the working class areas of the cities, those voices were completely ignored. And those areas never joined in the protests against Evo Morales. And it's those areas that have now taken back power after voting for the MAS and after winning, taking back the country.
And Oli Vargas, I wanted to ask you about the situation with the military. Obviously, the military was able to force Evo Morales from power back then. What is your sense of where the military is right now? Are they going to accept this result, or do you expect will the new government expect increasing confrontation with the military, or will there be an attempt to remove military commanders by the new president?
Well, that's a very interesting question. Throughout the past year under Añez's government, there's actually been a reorganization of the military to further entrench the sort of right-wing forces into the top brass. There's been a number of promotions, illegal promotions, I might add, because in Bolivia, military promotions have to be approved by the legislature. And because the legislature is elected, the MAS has a majority in there, and they rejected these promotions because they were political moves. They're placing the most right-wing, the most pro-US, the most corrupt sections of the military and promoting them into positions of generals, etc. So what's going to happen now? Obviously, none of us know. But something very interesting happened yesterday in that the top military general, Sergio Orellana, who is one of the most right-wing figures within the military and who was promoted to that position by Añez's government, he released quite a bizarre public letter attacking the current regime for supposedly insulting the military at some event. Apparently, the interior minister referred in a derogatory manner to some ranks of the military. But what this means really is he's looking for a reason, looking for something with which to distance himself from the current government so as to curry favor with the MAS, with the left. And that shows the strength of the victory in that the armed sections of the state that turned against Evo Morales now feel that they have to swim with the tide, swim with the popular tide that is so overwhelming at this point. It speaks to the power and the sort of momentum behind the left here in Bolivia. Going forward, it's going to be incredibly difficult. It's clear that there needs to be a reorganization, at least on some level within the military. I mentioned earlier that there's been a reorganization, number of right-wing figures being promoted. There's a huge base of support for the MAS within the military, and those people are incredibly upset about the promotions that happened a few months ago. So I'm sure those factions of the military will want now to have their place at the top. But in this transitional period between the coup government and the restoration of democracy, when Luis Arce takes power, the MAS will have to depend on the military as it's currently constituted to not carry out a second coup. That's a concern, obviously. that if they alienate the military too much, then there could be even more violence between now and sort of early December when Luis Arce officially takes power.
Will the military be held accountable for massacres that took place of indigenous people and their supporters during this brief period of the coup? Jeanine Añez herself, will she be held accountable? And then what about the return of Evo Morales to Bolivia, Ali?
Absolutely. That's been a key demand from day one of the popular movements that are the mass that form the coalition that is the movement towards socialism. It's justice for the massacres of Sencata El Alto, Sacaba, Cochabamba, Pedregales, La Paz, Yapacani, Santa Cruz. And they've got three key figures they're looking at the moment. Añez herself, the Interior Minister Arturo Murillo, who ordered the massacres, and Defense Minister Fernando López, as well as some of the generals who were there on the ground, as well, actually, mass lawmakers have been filing criminal charges against some of the generals who were coordinating with far-right paramilitary groups during the coup, such as the Resistencia Juvenil Cochala, sort of a motorbike gang that was working with the police to repress indigenous protests just after the coup in November. So I think Luis Arce and the MAS and all the candidates of the MAS have been very clear, even Evo Morales himself, that the MAS is not looking to take revenge, is not looking to polarize society once again. But there will be justice for the people who gave their lives just after the coup in the fight for democracy. So that's a key demand. Justice for the massacres.
Ali Vargas, I want to thank you for being with us from La Paz, Bolivia, with Casachun News. And I wanted to bring in for a moment Leonardo Flores, who is the Latin America campaign coordinator of Code Pink, who was part of an election observer delegation that was in Bolivia for these elections. Leonardo, your observations about what happened and the significance. Can you put the significance of this MAS victory, this socialist victory in Bolivia, in the context of what's happening in Latin America today?
Yes, thank you for having me on, Amy. First of all, I would say that my delegation witnessed a free and fair vote, very few irregularities, certainly no trends at a national level in terms of irregularities. So this is a huge, huge victory, not just for the Bolivian people, but for democracy in general. And it's a blow against neoliberalism and fascism in this country. In terms of the broader context, certainly we have upcoming elections next year in Ecuador and in Chile. There's already talk of kind of a new pink wave coming to Latin America. That pink wave refers to a period in the early 2000s when progressive governments took power everywhere from Brazil to Argentina to Venezuela and in other places.
You mentioned the pink tide. Clearly, the pink tide had tremendous setbacks over the last decade or so in places like Brazil, Ecuador, Peru, Argentina. What gives you a sense that what happened in Bolivia this week is an indication that the right-wing governments that have been coming to power in many of these countries can be turned back?
Well, in the past year, we've seen massive protests in Ecuador, in Colombia, in Chile, of course. And here in Bolivia, the fact that so many people turned out on the streets over the summer, hundreds of thousands, that's what led them to set the date for the elections, to fix the date for the elections. And I think that's going to inspire people around the region, and it's going to show them that people's power really can overcome these neoliberal and fascist governments that have taken power over the past 5 or 6 years in Latin America. But another thing that we have to mention also is really the role played by the OAS in this coup last year and destabilizing all of Latin America, particularly during the tenure of Luis Almagro, the current Secretary General of the OAS.
And what do you see as the Trump administration's attitude now with the results in Bolivia?
Well, to be honest, I don't think the Trump administration is going to be paying much attention to Bolivia. Their attention in Latin America is based mostly, almost exclusively on Venezuela, Cuba, and Nicaragua. And that has to do a lot with the vote in Florida, with expats from Venezuela and Cuba who have donated a lot of money and can turn out the vote in Florida, which is obviously a very key state in the upcoming elections.
And the significance of the role of the United States in the coup that ousted the Bolivian president, Evo Morales, who will soon be returning to Bolivia?
Well, that's a very important role played by the United States. So the USAID, the U.S. Agency for International Development, has been funding Bolivian groups, Bolivian right-wing groups, since the early 2000s. And in particular, we know that because of WikiLeaks, we know that the U.S. Embassy in Bolivia had an eye on Evo Morales way before he became president, when he was a social leader, when he was a union leader, and they identified him as a possible person that could coalesce the masses, coalesce the bases and the different social movements in the country, and eventually came to power. They were certainly right about that. But one of the other things they did was to come up with a plan to undermine Morales, and that plan was put in effect basically in 2019 with the help of the OAS, which played a key role, as I said before, through Luis Almagro, the Secretary General. The OAS basically put in a narrative in the media in Bolivia that there had been a fraud in the elections. Later, we find out from CEPR, the Center for Economic and Policy Research, and MIT analysts, and many others, that there was no such fraud, that the OAS result was the OAS analysis was completely flawed. For that reason, Code Pink is calling for Luis Almagro to resign. If people want to see, to join that call, go to codepink.org/OAS.
Well, we want to thank you so much, Leonardo Flores, for joining us, Latin American campaign coordinator of Code Pink, joining us from La Paz, Bolivia, where he's been leading Code Pink's election observation team all week. Again, the stunning news out of Bolivia right now, an outright victory for the ousted Bolivian president Evo Morales's MAS party. Now the president-elect that has been conceded by both sides is Luis Arce. This is Democracy Now! When we come back, Jelani Cobb joins us for his new documentary on who gets to vote. Stay with us. Son by Creedence Clearwater Revival. The song was written by member John Fogerty, who just issued an official cease and desist order Friday to President Trump for using it as part of his campaign soundtrack. The song came out in 1969 during the Vietnam War. Fogerty said, quote, "I wrote this song because as a veteran, I was disgusted that some people were allowed to be excluded from serving our country because they had access to political and financial privilege. I also wrote about wealthy people not paying their fair share of taxes. Mr. Trump is a prime example of both of these issues. The fact that Mr. Trump also fans the flames of hatred, racism, and fear while rewriting recent history is even more reason to be troubled by his use of my song," said John Fogerty. This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The Quarantine Report. I'm Amy Goodman with Juan González. Today marks 2 weeks from November 3rd, official election day. Amidst the pandemic, more than 30 million people nationwide have already voted through mail-in ballots or early voting, about a fifth of the total number of votes cast in 2016. It's shattering all records for voting. Early voting begins today in Wisconsin and Utah. As voters in the United States choose their next president, we spend the rest of the hour with journalist and professor Jelani Cobb. In the new Frontline documentary, Whose Vote Counts?, Cobb collaborates with Columbia Journalism School, Columbia Journalism Investigations, and reporters from USA Today Network to examine one of the first elections held during the pandemic, Wisconsin's April 2020 primary. This is an excerpt of the film, which he narrates.
Lines as folks wait for their polling place. You can see
they've made it so difficult for people to vote here, just asking too much of people to come out with this virus going on.
It was a major election in the middle of a pandemic.
There's been confusion around what actually is allowed.
It was difficult to request an absentee ballot.
I didn't even know how to do it.
I didn't know about that option to vote through the absentee voting.
Mail ballots, they cheat, okay? People cheat. Mail ballots are fraudulent in many cases.
Absentee ballots delayed in the mail.
I requested an absentee ballot,
but didn't come in time.
It never came.
So I was forced to go and vote
at one of the 5 polling stations.
Voters forced to choose between their health and their civic duty.
Those lines are long in Wisconsin, despite the state's safer at home order.
It is unethical.
It was such a putrid decision.
People are going to die because of this.
Claims of voter suppression.
Ballots, any ballots received after April 13th will be rejected.
750 ballots so far have been rejected.
I'm really frustrated because my vote won't count.
It was the most blatant form of voter suppression.
Was this all a view of things to come?
I just can't imagine that somebody would do that in this country.
In the impending presidential election. Historian. I've been studying American elections for years, but I've never seen anything like this moment. The threat of a constitutional crisis over an election with the votes of many Americans, especially people of color, may not count.
First of all, were you able to vote?
You know, I was not, but I had an absentee ballot.
These people wanted to vote this past April in the battleground state of Wisconsin. A primary that would turn out to be a telling dress rehearsal for the election chaos the rest of the country is now engulfed in.
I think we're seeing elected officials, specifically on the Republican side, that are playing politics with people's lives.
I started focusing on the state because of its pivotal and deeply partisan nature. It split down the middle between Republicans and Democrats, and it gave Donald Trump the presidency in 2016 by the exceedingly thin margin of 22,000 votes. It's a microcosm of America these days.
I do believe that there is an attack on our democracy right now. And
along with colleagues at the Columbia Journalism School, I began doing remote interviews there when the pandemic was just taking hold.
We don't need to be trying to have an election in the middle of a pandemic.
With reporters from the Milwaukee Journal Sentinel and USA Today, we examined the voting, especially the absentee ballots, how they were used and counted, and the political and legal fights around them.
An excerpt from the Frontline documentary, Whose Vote Counts, premiering tonight, Tuesday night, on PBS. In 30 seconds, we'll be joined by Jelani Cobb, the documentary's producer. We'll be back with him in 30 seconds.
I count slowly, slowly, slowly getting faster. Once I start in counting, it's very hard to stop. Hey, faster, faster, it is so exciting. I could count forever, count until I drop. 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, I love counting, whatever the amount. 1, 2, 3, 4. Hey, 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 hey. 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, that's it. Song of the Count.
Song of the Count by The Count. This is Democracy Now! I'm Amy Goodman with Juan González. We're joined by Jelani Cobb, the producer and narrator of the and reporter of the Frontline documentary, Whose Vote Counts, that premieres tonight on PBS. He's a professor of journalism at Columbia University and a contributor to The New Yorker magazine. Jelani, it's great to have you back with us. You talk about Wisconsin, which begins early voting today, as a kind of microcosm of America. Why? Why did you focus there, and what are you most concerned about?
Well, I mean, there were so many things in Wisconsin. You know, we were looking at all of the potential obstacles. So we started this project before the coronavirus hit, and we were looking at all the potential dynamics that could impede people's ability to cast a ballot. And when we were looking around, we saw Wisconsin, just so many of them were happening in Wisconsin. And it was also important, you know, for us to look at Wisconsin, not only because of what's happened there in the last decade, under Scott Walker and the Republican legislature and the extreme gerrymandering that's there, the really strict voter ID law, one of the strictest voter ID laws in the country, you know, all of those things that we thought were significant. But also, they were, this is a state where, you know, the presidency was essentially decided in the last election, you know, just that sliver of 22,000 votes and, you know, things would turn out a different way. And so that was all, you know, looking around and saying that this was important. And then one other additional factor is that, you know, it's a state in the north where we wanted people to be aware that this is not just the familiar John Lewis story of Selma and Mississippi and Georgia and South Carolina, the places that we know to be the kind of usual suspects as it relates to voter suppression. We're now looking at a fire that has spread across the country, and we're dealing with voter suppression concerns in states that were in the Union, and Wisconsin, which is where the Republican Party was founded, you know, by people who were outraged by the 1854 Kansas-Nebraska Compromise that might have allowed the spread of the further spread of slavery. And so you have this bastion of progressivism, this place that is a cornerstone of American progressive politics. And now we're mired in a situation wondering about whether or not people will have access to the vote. And one last thing I do want to say before I kind of go to further in the conversation is that I'm the correspondent and narrator for the film, but my colleagues June Cross and Tom Jennings are the producers for it.
Jelani, I wanted to ask you, you mentioned the history of progressivism. This is Wisconsin is known not only as the birthplace of the Republican Party, but deep into the 20th century, it was also a hotbed of Republican progressivism, Bob La Follette, and also of a very extensive socialist movement. There were even socialist mayors in Milwaukee up until the mid-20th century. So were you able to get at what has happened to have this dramatic shift now into this sort of leading edge of voter suppression?
Sure. And I'll just say really quick as an aside, Juan, it's really great to talk to you. I use your book in my class, and so I'm glad to be able to have this conversation with you. Well, you know, with Wisconsin, there's a really good book on this, you know, Dan Kaufman's book, you know, The Fall of Wisconsin, where he traces this. And one of the real key factors here was the involvement of the Bradley Foundation, which is a foundation that was spun off from an industrial magnate, a set of two brothers, who initially, in the, you know, first part of the 20th century, when they began getting into philanthropy, they were doing things that were pretty mundane, you know, supporting local causes and, you know, being a boon to, you know, community concerns. And then they kind of veered seriously to the right, you know, in the 1970s, 1980s, and began funding efforts, especially around anti-labor union activism. And so, you know, Scott Walker was by and large a product of the Bradley Foundation's largesse. And, you know, it was really a kind of idea that they wanted to make Wisconsin, after 2008 in full steam, to make Wisconsin a laboratory for what they wanted to do in the rest of the country. And so it almost seems too perfect when we look at the issues that are there. It's a kind of, you know, checklist of the things that we think about with the right wing. And, you know, the assault on labor unions, the assault on voter protections, the assault on, you know, all the aspects of the social safety net. And, you know, for my lifetime growing up, we now talk about Wisconsin as a purple state or, you know, a battleground state. But when for most of my life, we've thought about Wisconsin as a fairly progressive and safely Democratic state. And this has been a product of very much a concerted effort over the past decade, well, past several decades, by private philanthropy there.
And your documentary focuses a lot on the battle, especially over the legal fights over absentee ballots. Now, I know President Trump is constantly talking about that mail ballots are fraudulent. Obviously, there's not a whole lot of very little to buttress that argument. But there are concerns that and anyone who has done a mail-in ballot knows that it's a lot more complicated to fill it out properly, and it's a lot easier for ballots to be rejected at the time of the count. I'm wondering if you could talk about the potential for significant numbers of people who do vote to, because they are doing a mail-in ballot, that they don't fill it out correctly and that it then gets rejected at the count time.
Well, so I think, if anything, the last 4 years have taught us to fairly reliably look at what Donald Trump accuses other people of, and that's a pretty good indicator of what it is he's actually doing. And so the allegations that, you know, mail-in voting is rife with fraud and, you know, people cheat and they do all these, that doesn't hold up, you know, including, you know, states like Oregon, where they conduct their mail, their elections entirely by mail. And not only do they have successful elections with no significant hint of there being ballots that are improperly cast or you know, people cheating, but they consistently have one of the highest voter turnout rates in the country. And sometimes the highest, you know, voter turnout rate in the country. And I'll come back to that and the relevance of that for 2020 in a minute. But the opposite side of this is that we do see there being a disparity in the number of absentee ballots that are rejected, particularly as they come from communities of color. And that was one of the things that the Columbia Journalism Investigations Team found when they delved into the rejected voter rolls in Wisconsin and then traced those down to particular communities. Communities that were heavily Black and brown were more likely to have their ballots rejected. This shouldn't be entirely a shock if we remember back to just 2018 when we saw the battles around exact match signature ballots in Georgia. And what Brian Kemp was attempting to do in terms of using the exact match between an absentee ballot and the signature that they have on file for you. And if there was any disparity between those two things, they would toss the ballot. Or if there was any disparity between how your name was spelled, including having a hyphen, you know, in your name that may or may not appear on your driver's license and so on, then your ballot would be tossed. And so those same sort of dynamics appear to have been the case on April 7th and could potentially, the real kind of foreboding thing is that they could potentially have the same sort of impact or the same sort of dynamic in the ballots that are being cast ahead of November 3rd.
Jelani, I wanted to turn to a clip of your documentary, Whose Vote Counts, where you interview the Democratic National Committee's top lawyer, Mark Elias, as well as others.
The national parties joined the fight. What they would do here would be a harbinger for the coming presidential election. The Democratic National Committee filed one of several lawsuits to make absentee voting easier, seeking to loosen requirements like voter ID and witness signatures, things that historically have been obstacles, especially for people of color.
The DNC filed the initial lawsuit when it became clear that there were going to be serious problems with availability for voting.
Mark Elias is the DNC's top lawyer. What exactly is at stake? And I mean this on the granular level. There are multiple dozens of lawsuits. What's being fought over?
Most of what's being fought over is the ability for voters to have access to the polls and for their votes to count. A lot of the litigation we're seeing in 2020 is, are mail-in ballots going to be rejected for technical reasons, or are we going to enfranchise voters?
So that's the Democratic National Committee's top lawyer, Mark Elias. You spend some amount of time in this documentary, Jelani, speaking to him. There are hundreds of these challenges all over the country. Yeah. Can you talk about his significance in these lawsuits and whether you see on Election Day the whole election being thrown into court, of course, which could ultimately lead to the Supreme Court, which might have a new justice on that Supreme Court and named Amy Coney Barrett?
Right. And so I think the comparison you might make is if you are preparing to watch a baseball game and then, you know, the coaches of the respective teams come out and they start arguing over who's going to bat first. And then they're arguing about how many innings they're going to be. And then there's a dispute about how many pitches it will take to strike out and how many balls it will take to walk. And every single aspect of how the game is played is up for dispute. So really the winner will wind up being the team that, you know, fares best with only two outs instead of three, or fares best in seven innings instead of nine. And that's really what we're seeing now. These lawsuits across the country are fighting about how much early voting there will be, about how long after the election a vote that is cast by mail can come in and still be counted, when they have to be postmarked by, like every kind of particularity that you can imagine as it relates to this election is being fought over. And there, I think the last count, there were 241 lawsuits between the Democrats, Republicans, outside interested parties, and they're going through dozens of states. And so when we get to the tallies on November 3rd, and however long after that it takes for us to understand who has actually won, some part of that will reflect what was won and what was lost in these lawsuits that have been kind of working their way through the system for the past several months.
And Jelani, you mentioned these battles. I recall back in the 2000 election when they were counting ballots in Florida that the Republican Party fought very hard to assure that military ballots, absentee ballots that have come in from overseas after the deadline would still be counted, and raise the issue, how can you disenfranchise a serviceman overseas? And they successfully got an extension for the military ballots that were coming in late. Now we're seeing the Republican Party doing the opposite, trying to prevent any ballots that come in after the election day from being counted. But I wanted to ask you about Hans von Spakovsky, who you deal with, and the role he's played in shaping the narrative for the Republican Party around absentee ballots and how they're subject to fraud.
Sure. Just as a quick point about your first point relating to people fighting to have absentee ballots from military people serving in the armed forces still be counted. You know, the entire Republican Party is not a monolith on this. You know, so what Donald Trump says and what, you know, other people in the party will tell you if you kind of talk to them are not necessarily the same thing, you know, because a lot of older people prefer to cast their ballots by mail, and a disproportionate share of the Republican electorate is older. And so when you start hearing the tirades about don't trust mail-in votes, the absentee votes are all, you know, riddled with fraud and cheating and so on, there's a quiet panic, you know, among a number of people who are Republicans who are saying, listen, we could really, like, mess around and disenfranchise part of our own electorate here. And so I think that's been a concern, you know, a very obvious concern. Now, about Hans von Spakovsky, he's an interesting figure. I would say arguably more than anyone else, von Spakovsky is responsible for the promulgation and proliferation of the concern about voter fraud. You know, this has been his issue. You know, he's been their guy on this thing. He created a database with the Heritage Foundation that logs instances of alleged voter fraud. Our investigation pointed to something else, that, you know, many of the cases that were there were simply people who...
Jelani, we have 20 seconds.
People who made mistakes in casting their ballot and so on. And so he's really been more responsible than anyone else for promulgating the myth of voter fraud.
Well, we are going to do part two of our interview at democracynow.org. Check it out, with Jelani Kopp, correspondent and writer for the new PBS Frontline documentary, Whose Vote Counts, that premieres tonight, Tuesday night, directed by June Cross, produced by Tom Jennings. Kopp is also professor of journalism at Columbia University and contributor to The New Yorker magazine. We will speak to him about Biden's moral imperative to safeguard civil rights and Election Day violence, a history. I'm Amy Goodman with Juan González. Thanks so much for joining us.